Hello, my name is Marco Clausen. I am co-founder of Prinzessinnengarten and want to explain some of the topics related to this project and the questions of the conference Evicted by Greed. To start from the beginning, in 2009, Robert Shaw, my back then partner, and me decided to create an organization with the purpose of transforming urban wasteland into thriving community gardens, specifically with the purpose of learning and bringing people together. It was not started as a project of resistance or a project of occupying land in the city. It was started with the idea that we need places to learn more about how to grow food, how food is grown in the world, and its social and ecological impacts. We wanted a place where people come together and get practically engaged in shaping their urban environment, but at the same time also relearning their connection to nature, to food, to soil, to the diversity of plants and animals. So the idea was to also create a place that follows a different logic from what usually a city is like in terms of everything has a function, a clear rule, it's made for profit, it's made for out of concrete, it's made for cars and business and so forth. So the idea was to create this kind of oasis and show people that cities can look different and our participation in transforming the urban landscape and environment can be very different from just planning from above or planning by an investor. So this was the original idea. What makes Prinzessinnengarten special in comparison to other community gardens, and we have around 200 in Berlin, is that we started the project as a kind of a social business. So the idea was to also create employment for people who do the social and educational work, who maintain the garden, who keep order in the garden and so forth, and try to finance this being independent from public funding. And the idea was to combine a for-profit and a non-profit. So the for-profit is mainly gastronomy on site. And we designed it in a way that every surplus that we make from the bar and the restaurant would go into the non-profit activities, specifically in paying people who got who had an expertise in the topics that I talked about. So it started also in a very like Berlin way of doing projects. I think it's important to understand also the uniqueness of this place, of the city, especially in the last 20 or 30 years. So we started as a temporary use project, just saying, if it doesn't work, we just move on. If it doesn't work here, we move on. If there's an investor or the owner has different ideas, we will move on. And that was also kind of due to the way we experienced Berlin in the last two or three decades. Berlin was kind of the capital of unused land and the center for different historical reasons. There was the wall, of course, which separated the city in two, but there was also strong processes of deindustrialization after the First World War and then the Second World Wave after reunification and basically dismantling the heavy industries of the GDR. And there was never this kind of rapid growth that was promised after reunification in the 90s and later on. On the contrary, Berlin was a capital that was not economically strong, that didn't attract so many investors. So that meant for a long time, there was a lot of places unclaimed and unused, and people didn't know what to do with it. So a lot of the Berlin kind of alternative culture is based of having access to this land or just claiming this land to do different forms of projects and activities, including club culture, art, and so on. In early 2009, when we approached different owners to get access to land, the impact of the global real estate and financial crisis start to hit the German market and also the Berlin market. At that moment, when we start negotiating, it wasn't even clear if the banks will survive the crisis. We were looking for places being possible to use. It turned out extremely complicated to find the owners, even if there were public ones, because in Germany, access to ownership data is not so easy. We ended up talking to the borough of Friedrichshain-Kreuzberg, to the mayor of the borough, who advised us to talk to an agency I until then had never heard about, which was the real estate fund of the city of Berlin. It was basically a city-owned real estate company with only one purpose. And I was astonished myself that even being interested in what's happening in the city, I never heard about an agency like this with the purpose of selling publicly owned real estate to the international market for the highest price. But in this moment, in 2009, the investors were gone. They didn't end up in jail, but they were not around, at least for a moment. So we started negotiating with them about Moritzplatz, which was back then a not extremely attractive place, even for us, because of the roundabout. It's not in the center of a neighborhood, more at the edge. It's a difficult site back then. It was a difficult site, but also for investors, because this part of Berlin didn't seem very attractive. Statistically, it has the poorest population in Berlin. A lot of different problems, including drugs, low unemployment rates, and as I said, also as an urban environment, it was not very attractive, being mostly dominated by cars. So we started with a one-year contract. And we had to pay, for our standards, a lot of money, €2,400 to get access to the land, which was not used for 50, 60 years. There was a department store being bombed in the war, torn down in the 50s. And since then, the place was basically collecting trash. So what we had to do was cleaning up on our own with the help of a lot of people that we had to, that we invited to start the project together with us. There was no electricity, no water, nothing. And we took a high risk because, as I said, one-year contract, even if you're a mobile or temporary project, that's not a long time. Also, having in mind everything that you have to do to transform a place like this into a garden. We used mobile elements to stick to the idea of being able to transport the whole garden in case needed. That was 2009, but also there was a Berlin attitude to the whole thing. There might be plans from the government, from investors, but often they failed and then you would just go on doing what you do. And then we started building that garden and it grew, it got more attention. There was a whole hype around urban gardening. Prinzessinnengarten ended up in the media, in the New York Times, in the Guardian. Tens of thousands of people visited the place, including tourists, but also hundreds of people helped creating it, maintaining it. We had a lot of programs, workshops, public discussions on the topics related to the garden, which is not just the ecological growing of food, but also the social-ecological transformation. We were talking about agriculture in the region around Berlin, but also on a global context, the impact of agriculture to climate change. So it became also a learning site for a lot of different people to raise awareness of, on the one hand, the local possibilities of making a change, but also the broader context of what's going on in the world. In terms of, for example, loss of biodiversity, use of pesticides in agriculture, the social and ecological damages. By now, this is a mainstream topic. When we started 10 years ago, there was a niche also of discussion in, within, for example, initiatives in the city, right to the city initiatives, but also in the overall discussion, like Today we know of the threat of massive loss of biodiversity. When we started beekeeping in the city to also make people aware of the problems we have with heavy industrialized agriculture and monocultures and the massive effects it will have on the way we live, that was considered something awkward, even hippie-esque, not so interesting for a lot of people, also for people being politically engaged. So in a way, maybe this and other gardens helped a little bit to broaden the discussion, to make people aware, and not just on a theoretical or abstract level, not just with proclamations and banners, but by actually experience how an alternative can look like and how people can actively engage in this kind of transformation. So we created this kind of little oasis, typical kind of Berlin subculture alternative space that follows a different logic. It has different aesthetics, invites people to be actively part in it. But we did it being under threat all the time. As I said, the contract was only for a year, then got prolonged another year and another year. We slowly managed to build up a more or less sustainable economy around that place, employing up to 30 people, and building a framework that could hold the place in all its activities and allow other people to use it as well. So Prinzessinnengarten became also a platform of a lot of different initiatives and groups to be used for all sorts of projects related to the topics of the garden, to the topics of the neighborhood, agriculture, and so forth. So, but then also me personally, I got politicized around topics. I wasn't so much knowing about before, as I already mentioned in terms regarding the real estate fund. Because also, interestingly, Prinzessinnengarten became one of the major cases of the discussion around privatization of real estate. So this privatization in Berlin goes on like basically since reunification. You have to be aware that half of the city was publicly owned and most of it was handed over to different forms of private ownership. The industries, but also part of the housing, and so on. So, and also the municipality since the '90s was in high debts. So, and already, kind of, experimenting with the methods of austerity that we all know by now, meaning public debts, being used also as an argument to give so-called assets to the private market and private ownership, specifically in the form of handing it over to a market to whoever gives the most money, which means that on the long run, only big companies, investment funds, and so on, had a chance to take over public property, which included not just real estate, but also, of course, the water, the electricity, part of public transport in the form of the railway. So you know all the story. And the promise was that over time, we will be able to pay for the public debts and the market will, of course, be so efficient that everything will be cheaper, smoother, and so forth. So most of it turned out to be a blunt lie, of course, but we could experience how this process works also very concretely in Prinzessinnengarten, because there the place itself and the neighborhood became a magnet for investment. Overall, of course, a lot of investment came with the answer to the financial crisis, which was printing money. And this money was pumped into real estate everywhere in the world, so also in Berlin. So when we talk about gentrification, just as, you know, as a problem of latte macchiatos, art galleries, and so on, I think we're missing the point. There was a huge financial transformation coming with the crisis, and allowing this money to be used, this printed money, this bailout money, this quantitative easing, to be pushed into real estate. And this worked only also in Berlin in a combination with the state or the municipality handing over publicly owned property to the market and to this kind of investment. This all took place in a moment when the market was the lowest and the interest rates were the highest, meaning that also in Berlin, we sold more than 3,000 pieces of land. Compared to today's prices, for almost nothing. And with the income we paid the banks that we bailed out, very high interest rates, meaning that the debts basically didn't change, but we lost most of the publicly controlled real estate and places. So in 2012, there was a decision, and it's of course not transparent, it's not made publicly, but behind closed doors, to sell the piece of land of Prinzessinnengarten to an investor. Interestingly, at the same time, Prinzessinnengarten became so famous that the Berlin government even invited the president of the Federal Republic of Germany to see this place as an example of this great Berlin alternative culture. We started a campaign, we collected 30,000 signatures, we were able to stop the privatization. We were not able to stop the whole mechanism, but it was more critically discussed from then on. And by now, with a new government, of course, you probably heard about it from other people, there is ideas and also certain practices to start to reclaim what was privatized before, specifically public housing. But back then, that was not even discussable. Even mentioning this was a kind of weird idea, because there was this kind of mainstreaming of privatization, this normalization, where everything else than austerity was almost being seen as, you're not from this world, you're not from this planet, we don't have an alternative. And that was that was true for almost every party in the parliament. So to make this brief, we got another contract for 5 years back then, also with the support of the borough, which ended in 2018. And within the garden, especially the group that was also dependent on the income and made this a social business, decided to not fight for this place on the long run, because this kind of political fight is also extremely draining. It takes away, of course, time and nerves, and look for an alternative. And they found it on a graveyard in Köln, another borough. So they moved out last year, beginning of this year, and started a new project on a graveyard with much longer tenure. For Prinzessinnengarten itself at Moritzplatz, we managed to convince the borough to give this place at least another 2 to 6 years to try out another approach of making this garden a commons, to make it accessible for everybody, to still go on having it as a place of social ecological learning. We even managed, which is in Berlin also quite rare, to get a funding of 300,000 euro to do this. And there was now an association called Common Grounds who's in the process of trying to figure out how this will look like. When we talk about commons, we have to break this down to a much more like down-to-earth realization of what it takes to actually create this kind of spaces. When it comes to the meaning of this place, I think it's not really about creating more biodiversity, creating more food in terms of scale, but to make people aware how important these questions are in the bigger picture. I mean, I personally can only say what we know about climate catastrophe, what we know about the massive loss of species on this planet, and all the ecological and social impacts, including migration, including loss of access to fresh water, all the wars that will be started around this so-called resources. We will see a world that will be completely changed. And this, the pandemic we are living through right now, I think it's just a glimpse of what is ahead. So instead of fetishizing the small projects as great examples of how the world can be different, we have to see them just as small platforms to look in a different future that is more social and ecological just. But it's also true that we are doing this as more privileged, mostly white, middle class, well-educated people. And we have to use these places, I think, as a platform for other people, other places to have the possibility to voice what's going on in the world. This is why we use Prinzessinnengarten or the Neighborhood Academy to invite activists, for example, from Brazil, where we destroyed rainforests on a massive scale just to have cheap meat here on our plate every day. We have to rethink the city as an ecosystem that is more giving than taking. That would mean to take away, of course, the streets from the cars, to think about different forms of energy, but also of a different economy. So, yeah, that's my hope for places like Prinzessinnengarten. And that would be my comment to the question raised in this conference. Thanks for your attention.